In Iceland, we finally have some good news, as the danger level in the fully evacuated town of Grindavik is going to be lowered from its highest level to the second highest level on November 23rd, about 8 hours before this video is published. As a result, residents will be allowed once again back into the town to collect their valuables along with the media, with the official rules listed in a linked article in this video's description. The cause for the sudden change is that while theoretically, on paper, a volcanic eruption could begin in the town with little or no warning, relevant sensors and analysis suggest that such a scenario is now in the short to midterm future highly unlikely. Instead, if an eruption was to occur, the most likely region would be this approximate area, with an eruption at the northern edge of this patch of land being the most likely. Thus, here is what was the hazard zone map for November 21st, and here is the updated map for November 22nd. I also want to note that on November 22nd, the alert level of the Reykjanes volcano was changed as it was lowered from orange to yellow. Since we are now 31 days into this volcanic unrest, many locals and members of my audience alike have a wide range of questions. This video will answer some of these questions. The first question relates to something everyone deeply cares about, pets and animals. Have all the birds and animals, including the 5 missing cats, been removed from Grindavik? To this, I am happy to report that they have, at least per my source. Why are the residents not allowed enough time to go into the town with moving trucks to load all their possessions at their own risk? This relates to a safety issue. While decreasing, levels of toxic sulfur dioxide gas are still seeping into Grindavik through cracks, and there is still a possible, albeit low chance, an eruption could unexpectedly begin within the town. The reason for the limited access relates to this and the fact that access was designed around everyone who is temporarily in town being able to evacuate in under an hour, which would not be possible if longer stays were allowed. I saw a report that the Snæfellsjökull volcano produced a 20,000-foot-high volcanic plume on November 21st. Did this actually happen? Luckily, the volcanic ash advisory you saw was indeed posted, but it was merely an exercise, with these sorts of exercises occurring a few times a year across the various volcanic ash advisory centers. Are the lava barriers being built to divert the lava flow likely to be successful to protect Grindavik and infrastructure? As the author of this question notes, lava barriers have a mixed track record and is generally a coin flip whether they are successful. However, they do seem to work some of the time, and thus it is economic to build than to not build them when you factor in the reduced risk of expected property damage were an eruption to occur. However, I must note that the lava barriers being built around the Svartsengi geothermal power plant are going to be 10 meters or 32.8 feet tall, which is higher than the average lava barrier I have encountered. Thus, I believe it has a slightly greater than 50% chance of being successful if a lava flow was to reach this wall. Is an eruption still likely? An eruption no longer is imminent in my opinion or likely in the short term. However, since magma is once again building in volume at the same location that it was before the first dike intrusion occurred, it might once again create another magmatic intrusion if it reaches a specific threshold in volume. We are not at that point quite yet. In my opinion, the risk of an eruption is less than 5% unless another magma run and dike injection occurs. What type of volcano is most likely to form? While a fissure volcano is the most likely outcome, a small shield volcano or cinder cone are also less likely possibilities. Which arguments can be made to defend my prior assertion that if an eruption were to occur, it could be VEI 1 or 2? Mainly historical records and work involving ash layers involving prior eruptions from this volcano, which seem to have averaged that magnitude about 50% of the time. What would the effect be across Europe if an eruption did occur? Negligible. The only effect Europe might experience are minor air traffic disruptions for anyone flying over a small section of Iceland specifically. How can we tell if the intrusion below Grindavik has started to solidify? Although I could go on a 90-minute lecture on this subject, the simplest answer is that when objects increase in temperature, they expand. Thus, if magma at depth is cooling, it contracts, and this can be detected via overlying GPS sensors. Is there as great a fluorosis risk as there has been in past eruptions? While fluorosis can be a potential problem with any volcanic eruption, it is generally only a significant problem when it ejects large amounts of ash. And yet, even when this occurs, the effect is often only localized to the water supply of where fairly heavy ash falls. Truly heavy ashfall is not likely during a hypothetical eruption of the Reykjanes volcano. If you have any additional questions, comment them down below and I may answer them in a future video. Please subscribe as it supports this channel. As a final note, I would like to thank my new patron Clarence for supporting this channel.